I used to wonder why gluttony was considered a sin. There are other ways to do a bad job taking care of your health. It would be far simpler to claim that failure to be healthy is a sin. I've come to learn that isn't what gluttony means, though. Rather, gluttony is the sin of excess. When a beautiful thing such as food is no longer nourishing or even enjoyable. When your motivation for action is not pleasure, but simply a compulsion towards something which has already depleted in returns. To have this relationship with food is bad for your health. More importantly, to have this relationship with yourself is bad for your soul.
You're traveling through another dimension.
In the Twilight Zone episode, Time Enough at Last, we follow the story of Henry Bemis. Henry is a bank teller who isn't very good at his job. He spends his time reading during work hours, even when he's directly working with customers. His boss has enough of this, but Henry explains that he doesn't have time to read at home because his wife won't allow it. When we see him at home, we see the same issue. Henry is completely disengaged from reality. His wife becomes incredibly frustrated that she married a man that doesn't care about her, just his books. Henry doesn't care about the people around him or his responsibilities. He completely disengages from his humanity. This is the true nature of gluttony. The books, as art, do not deepen his engagement with the world, but rather flatten it. Suddenly, when Henry sneaks off to the bank vault to read, a hydrogen bomb drops on his city. As he steps out of the vault, he sees a world in ruins. Now, I would definitely like to point out at this point that Henry is definitely getting radiation poisoning. Dude is screwed. Aside from that, though, Henry struggles in this new world. He feels alone. And the tragic irony is that once people are no longer available for him, he starts to miss them. He laments, if only there was something to do.
The very worst part is being alone. Is this how it's gonna be? Just sitting around day after day, eating?
Just as he gives up hope, though, a miracle happens. He discovers a library with a whole array of books still intact. The whole episode, Henry found himself short on the time to read. For the first time, his desires and his situation intersected. He now had nothing but time for reading. Just as he basks in this beautiful discovery, though, a great tragedy strikes as his glasses break. These glasses appear to be of heavy prescription. Suddenly, Henry's fate is reversed. Where he once tried to escape from the present through reading, it now seemed that his goals and the present were aligned. The great tragedy is that as soon as he thought he had it, the opposite became true. Instead of engaging with books for the rest of his life, it was instead the present that he would have to engage with for as long as he lived. The thing that he once rejected became the only thing that he had left. Only this time, an emptier, lonelier present than he ever could have imagined. This is the essential quality of art gluttony, pulling you away from the present, from reality. Art, as an escape from reality, isn't necessarily a bad thing. But art, as a rejection of reality, will lead to the destruction of your soul. For Henry Bemis, this could only lead to one place. The Twilight Zone.
Gluttony.
Gluttony!
Is gluten-free.
Ooh, art gluttony, it's my video. Let's go. Art is, in a sense, the activity that humans do. Much like a beaver builds a dam, or a bird makes a nest, humans make art. Nobody told you to doodle in your notebook as a kid, you just did it. Humans came up with music and dance, and the person who feels no fear of shame feels compelled to participate.
If you don't sing when you're alone in your car, then I don't trust you as a human being.
In this way, art is fundamental to your humanity. It deepens your relationship with it. So, we have a disconnect then. How can I possibly say that art is both fundamental to your humanity and destructive to your humanity? In many ways, I do want to be careful because my ultimate opinion is that art is not only good for humanity, but also necessary. We need it if we want to develop our sense of self and understanding and empathy for others. If we look at Henry Bemis, we see the disconnect. Books took the place of reality for him. Through gluttony, Art essentially becomes the opposite of itself. Books serve as an interesting case study because in a lot of ways it's hard for them to be perceived as gluttonous. Consider Matilda, for instance. They both do an inordinate amount of reading. Why is she celebrated by the text of her story while Bemis is disparaged? Is it simply because Matilda was originally a book and The Twilight Zone is a TV show? No, that wouldn't make much sense, although I am amused by the idea of Roald Dahl and Rod Sterling secretly fighting against each other's mediums. Matilda's situation is different, though. She's a young child with neglectful parents. When there are no other responsibilities that you have, reading becomes a commendable activity. In fact, quite beneficial. In Neil Postman's Amusing Ourselves to Death, he points out a time in American history when reading was the norm. He described the sort of person who was living in this time as having a typographic mind. Being well-read was expected, and people engaged deeply with the world around them as a result. People went to lectures for fun. The hottest new thing was a political manifesto against monarchy.
I do declare that this book is too political. For what reason must every author push their political agenda at every opportunity?
In that context, reading serves as a conduit for the deepening of humanity. But when it's applied to the wrong place, it becomes a problem. I was talking to my cousin, who's a mother. She loves to read, but feels as though her responsibilities as a mother take precedence over reading to the point where she feels as though it's almost a vice. Now, I don't know. The worm in my brain is telling me that everyone already knows that.
And the worm in my brain makes me think that the documents I've been forging have led to many deaths. But I know that's just silly.
Am I really breaking new ground? While we do have a general idea of excess being bad, I want to drill down into the ways in which art as gluttony becomes a problem. Part 1. Art gluttony disconnects you from yourself.
I'm forced to deal with what I feel. There is no distraction to mask what is real.
In the 21 Pilots song Car Radio, Tyler Joseph comes to terms with something that he is deeply unfamiliar with. Silence. The song catalogs his thoughts as his car radio is stolen, and he is left to sit alone with his own thoughts. It's the perfect picture of a man who is unfamiliar with himself, and uncomfortable with any thoughts that aren't hidden away by the sound of music. It's clear that Tyler no longer has an intimate relationship with his own soul. He complains that he has no distraction to mask reality. There's this sort of desperation that dominates the song. Tyler wants to stop thinking.
Oh my, too deep, please stop thinking. I liked it better when my car had sound.
It's clear that mental health issues play a part in the chaos of his mind. At the same time, Tyler acknowledges the necessity of thought. He describes a sort of dichotomy between faith and sleep. He describes faith as thinking, which to think is to be alive. The alternative is sleep. He doesn't describe it, but I think sleep is the result of gluttony, filling the silence to put his soul to sleep. Even then, though, he knows that thought is important, even as it tears him apart. There was so much thought pent up that Tyler can't bear it. Dr. K from Healthy Gamer has a good video on this phenomenon happening today.
Let's talk a little bit about emotional processing.
He describes how life seems to be getting harder today.
Look at people today, like I talk to a lot of people and it just seems like things are just getting harder.
It's a strange thing that life is so difficult these days. In many ways, life has gotten really convenient. Technology is advancing in really cool ways. All of the modern conveniences of life should make us happy, but they don't. Instead, we struggle through life, just trying to survive. Any little problem is so difficult to process. Why is that? Dr. K's argument is that we no longer have the time or the space to process emotions.
As a society, what we've lost sight of is the ability to emotionally process. In fact, it was so easy to do before that we don't even think about it necessarily like a skill, right? Like we kind of took it for granted.
There's so much opportunity for distraction that we deny ourselves the opportunity to even process the smallest of problems. The emotions don't get dealt with, so even the smallest of problems have a devastating impact on our well-being. In any time where you would normally process your emotions, you can drown it out with social media or music or podcasts. Do you ever get a burst of anxiety and then calm your emotions by pulling out your phone? That anxiety isn't going to go away. It's going to stick around if you don't deal with it. As a caveat, for people who have serious mental health problems, I can't really help you. I'm not a therapist. However, you don't have to have an anxiety disorder to end up in a rut of anxiety. I used to have unbearable anxiety at times before I learned to give myself space to process my emotions. I used to have a very unhealthy relationship with music. At any time it was socially acceptable, and even at times where it wasn't, I would put on music. I have some good memories of this time. I miss riding around my college campus on my skateboard, jamming to some Carly Rae. The problem was that it was all the time. I literally couldn't sit in silence. That's the sin of excess. I never allowed myself to sit in my own feelings. Some sort of stimulation always had to exist for me. As penance for my sin, I now have tinnitus. This constant ringing in my ears. Even a moderate amount of noise drowns it out, and I've learned to live with it. But I can never enjoy the sound of silence again. That's a really scary thought. It makes me sad. Never again will I sit in a quiet room without hearing that ringing. That incessant ringing. Every second. My refusal to live in silence has damned me to a life without it. One of my favorite albums is Pet Sounds. Brian Wilson recommended that if you want to enjoy the album fully and hear every sound in it, you have to listen to it with a headset. I can't listen this way. I can't turn up the volume enough to drown out the ringing without worrying that I'm going to damage my ears. I will never be able to listen to one of my favorite albums the way it was intended. There are greater tragedies in the world for sure, but it's hard not to feel a little heartbroken. The mistakes I made as a dumb kid will stick with me for the rest of my life. I'll never be free. Part 2. Art gluttony disconnects you from people. Okay, so I'm going to talk about The Last Jedi. It came out 6 years ago, so my hope is that we can have a mature discussion about this. Right? Anyway, where were you when The Last Jedi came out? I remember going to the theater with my friend. We were so excited. I accidentally bought tickets to the wrong theater, so when we showed up at the theater, we had to rush over to the theater that I bought the tickets for, and I remember getting stuck at the traffic light, and we were just like screaming, freaking out, like, we have to go see Star Wars, oh my gosh! I was really into the franchise at the time. I'd read all the new canon books. I couldn't wait for the movie. I spent all that time getting invested in the franchise, and then I saw this.
I just want to know what's going on.
Save him what we love.
Of course you do.
It's time to let old things die.
And it was awesome! The character-driven story was exactly what I wanted from a Star Wars movie. It explored the ideas of the Force and the history of the Jedi in interesting ways. The dramatic tension surpassed any Star Wars film before it. Sure, it wasn't perfect, but darn, it was great! I couldn't wait to go on the internet and see what other people appreciated about this movie. Surely this would go well. And then I got onto the internet and people didn't like it?
But I like that thing. I like that thing.
People were so upset, and I was upset at them. They weren't being fair to the movie. Tons of the criticisms were half-baked. A few were legitimate but overstated. I got super invested in the debate. It made me quite angry that so many people just didn't seem to understand this movie and were willfully misinterpreting it. Like, surely you understand that this bomber is more powerful than a Y-wing, right? Why is it even a question that these have different uses? Come on! And then anyone who tried to dissect the criticisms against this movie would be told that they were straw-manning their opponents if they didn't represent that individual person's arguments perfectly. Now, did I just make you mad? Or maybe, perhaps you felt elated that someone was finally brave enough to speak the truth. You could agree with my assessment or disagree, but if you were really invested in this discussion, then you probably understand where I'm coming from when I say that it traveled really far away from anything legitimate. It became an infinitely recurring backlash. We were like 6 steps away from an actual discussion, and it became the backlash to the backlash to the backlash. Just pure insanity. People got so invested, it felt political. This was a mass market movie. It just wasn't that relevant to our political landscape. I'm sorry. It wasn't. There are real political issues being discussed, and Star Wars just isn't one of them. I'm not just saying the other side was bad. This was universally stupid. There was no reason why we couldn't disagree respectfully. What did all that conflict get us to? I guess if you hated the movie, you could be happy that episode 9 served as a response to the backlash.
We need to pull some Holdo maneuvers. Do some real damage.
Come on, that movie is one in a million.
If that's your thing, then I guess congratulations. If it were me, though, I don't know if I'd be too thrilled about this end result, even if I despised The Last Jedi. And what did my investment in the conflict serve? I didn't change anybody's mind. I wasn't fighting for a morally just cause. I was fighting a culture war for a Disney product. I'll admit, what I did was pure insanity. Why did it matter so much to me that this movie be regarded the way I saw it? There's nothing wrong with disagreeing, but when you get this invested, it's your soul on the line. Your soul is more important than a piece of popular entertainment. Full stop. Defend your soul with vigor. Now, gluttony isn't a simple matter of enjoying something a lot. You can have a deep relationship with art, but the line gets blurry. When I transferred to Grand Canyon University my junior year, I was pretty lonely. I knew some of the people around me, but I didn't feel like I had a friend group of my own. I had no real community. My friend who worked at the esports arena told me about Smash Bros. Tournaments, and out of desperation, I decided to go to one. I showed up and made one friend that I would kind of awkwardly talk to. Neither of us were really great at the game. Most of our relationship was just asking each other how we were doing in the tournament and commiserating, since we never did well. I didn't connect well with many people, but at least it helped me feel a little less lonely. Over my Christmas break, a new game in the franchise came out. I hadn't really been practicing the game since I mostly just went to tournaments to meet people. I knew that I could probably get attention if I got better at the game. I worked really hard to practice at Smash. Hours of my life whittled away as I learned the little nuances and tech of the game. I spent an inordinate amount of hours grinding the frustrating online mode. I figured if I got good, it would open up opportunities for people to notice me as a person. Over time, I started to connect. I did find a community, and as I started going to more tournaments, more people started to talk to me. In many ways, my desire to get good at the game controlled me, though. I couldn't enjoy being with other people. When I went out and hung out with friends, my thoughts often drifted to how I needed to practice. My goal started out as a desperate hope to make friends. Instead, I withdrew from friends to pursue my goal of becoming the best Smash Bros. Player on campus. Somewhere along the way, my priorities got out of whack. I was in this to connect with other people, but I spent every night alone in my room practicing the game. The event that got me connected had nothing to do with my skills as a player. Rather, a friend invited me to play Mafia with them after the tournament. I became a figure in the community not because I got good at the game, but because of who I was as a person. People loved my sense of humor, and I would help set up the tournaments. I made friends. I started playing in my junior year, and as my senior year started to come to a close, I became obsessed with becoming the best player on campus. Or at least as close as I could get. I was really getting better too. I made the top players sweat when I played against them. With a couple of months left, I figured that I could easily win my first tournament. My senior year was almost over. I had to become the best. It was the culmination of the story that was so important to me. Every hour I could spend was oriented toward this goal. Suddenly, rumors about this pandemic that was starting to spread became more and more frequent. Out of nowhere, my school closed and ended my Smash Bros. Career. Suddenly, we were in lockdown. All of my ambition was wasted. The most important thing in my life was gone in an instant. All of the sacrifices I made were rendered moot. It raised the question of why I worked so hard. I got into this to make friends, not to become the best Smash Bros. Player on campus. Why did I have to be anxious on days when I couldn't practice? Those were the important times. The times that I wish that I really could have enjoyed. I ignored them because what I really cared about was boosting my ego. Smash Bros. Is an interesting game. I'm glad that I got to explore it on a deeper level, but it came at the cost of me making genuine connections with others. I'm not trying to say it's wrong to get good at a game, but my priorities were out of whack. I still probably could have been just about as good at the game without letting it disconnect me from others. I had friends who didn't play the game, and I couldn't be fully present when I was hanging out with them. For the rest of my life, I will relish the friends that I made, but my skill as a player has not impressed a single person. Nobody cares.
Watch my YouTube videos at 2x speed. 'Cause normal doesn't give me any dopamine.
I used to be pretty lonely. Not horribly so. Not enough to do anything about it, but I had a problem nonetheless. Sometimes it would be better than others. If I could fill my time just right, I could silence the emptiness in my heart. I was involved in some communities and was generally well-liked, but something felt wrong. I wasn't genuinely connecting with people. When I was truly alone, it was really difficult. But nothing that a 6-hour gaming session and a couple of drinks wouldn't fix. That was life for me. If I could drown out the silence, then maybe my needs wouldn't announce themselves. I knew that all things considered, my life wasn't too bad, but I had this nagging sadness that wouldn't go away. Sometimes, when I was on autopilot, I would Google the words, "Why am I so sad?" I didn't look at the answers. I knew that Google wouldn't help. My actions indicated something that I wouldn't admit to myself. There wasn't anything bad going on in my life. I wasn't even depressed. But something was wrong.
It's kind of embarrassing looking back. The answer was so obvious, and other people have since told me that they noticed I had a problem. It was something I had to figure out for myself, though.
My goal here is to be non-judgmental, but hopefully participate in this larger cultural discussion we're having. I want to share my experience of the dangers of art gluttony. Art is so important, and I love it dearly. You can actually experience a lot of it without being gluttonous. You have to be intentional about it, though. In a world that's built for you to have an unhealthy relationship with art, you desperately need to critically examine your relationship with it. Doing what everyone else is doing is a sure path to death. The floor is tilted towards addiction. I know life is tough, and there are certainly worse ways to cope with your problems. If the alternative to art gluttony is some worse form of addiction, then, you know, go ham. Like, I have absolutely no judgment for you. My hope is to be a guide and hopefully offer some direction. It was YouTube videos that helped me realize I need to get better. If my thoughts can help someone else, then I desperately want to play a part in that. I actually enjoy being around other people now. I'm actually an introvert, but by genuinely trying to connect with the people around me, I'm having deeper conversations. And I genuinely enjoy being around other people. I don't feel this need to go home as soon as it's socially acceptable. I'm fully present where I am, and it's been a great joy to me. Even if you don't listen to me or take my advice to heart, I wish the best for you. It's a tough world out there, and I'm rooting for you. Okay, bye!